Good morning, everyone. I just wanted to quickly check in with you and start our next chapter in our book, Titanic Young Survivors. So you watched my video last week of what were your expectations. You got a quick overview on what the Titanic was like. You have pictures that you were able to look at to see the size of what the Titanic looks like. And then you also got some background knowledge. Okay, so that was that first chapter with that other teacher that we used on YouTube that you could listen to, okay? Now, today I'm going to read an additional chapter to let you guys hear a little bit about what another person's story was. So this is a woman by the name of Edith Brown, and I will give you a PowerPoint with some background knowledge on her, but first I want you to hear about her story. Is the Titanic doomed? The idea that the Titanic was fated for disaster never crossed Edith Brown's mind. Such a notion seemed ridiculous to the 15-year-old South African. But that disturbing thought did occur to her on the third day of the voyage. It happened while Edith and her mother, Elizabeth, were each reading a book in the ship's second-class library. So remember, second class is like the middle, right? First class means they have lots of money. Second class means they're well off. And then you've got third class, which is a lot of people who don't have money and are not living the luxurious lifestyle of the Titanic. So they are in the library reading books. A strange middle-aged woman walked over and struck up a conversation with Elizabeth. Edith paid her little attention until the woman said, "There's something about this ship that I find unsettling." So the word unsettling means that she's not feeling comfortable. Un means to not feel settled or not feel comfortable. Putting down her book, Edith was now all ears. So she's listening intently. She wants to hear what this woman has to say. Elizabeth, who by nature was a nervous person, cast an anxious glance toward Edith before asking the woman, "In what way?" "Quite frankly, I can't put my finger on it. But when we were in Queenstown, I felt kind of panicky. I wanted my husband to cancel the remainder of the voyage and get me off." The woman said that she and her husband had crossed the Atlantic several times before, but this was the first time she had ever felt this tense. So she's uncomfortable, she's anxious, she's nervous. "Since I've been on the ship, I haven't slept a wink. I have been feeling uneasy the whole time." Knowing how natural it was to become jittery herself, Elizabeth decided to end the conversation, telling the woman, "I do hope you get a good night's sleep and settle down a bit as the trip goes on." Then Elizabeth returned to her book. After the woman, whom neither saw again, left the library, Edith said, "Well, that was odd." She immediately thought of the disturbing moment during the boarding when she, her mother, and her father, Thomas, were walking up the gangway of the Titanic in Southampton. Thomas suddenly became faint, so he was like feeling nauseous, maybe he wanted to like pass out. His legs began to buckle, forcing him to grab the railing to keep from falling. "What on earth is the matter, Tom?" Elizabeth said, rushing to his aid. "I don't know, my dear," he replied, wiping his brow. "You're shaking, and your pal is a ghost." To Edith, it looked as though he had seen a ghost. After taking a few deep breaths, he stood up and said, "I think I'm over it now." His legs steady again, he mentioned to Elizabeth and Edith, "Let's get on board." Here in the library, Edith wondered out loud, "Is it possible Father had the same kind of premonition as that lady when we boarded? So did he have those same feelings that this other woman had?" "I shouldn't tell you this because I don't want you to worry," Elizabeth said. "But Father admitted to me later that he was overcome with a feeling that something bad was going to happen." She nervously tapped her finger on the book. "Should we be worried?" Edith shook her head. "Nothing is going to happen. This ship is unsinkable." She didn't dare tell her mother what Thomas had said on the day of the departure when the Titanic nearly collided with another ship. Collided means they almost crashed. As the Titanic was leaving the narrow channel in the harbor of Southampton, it moved past the American liner New York, which was moored alongside another ship. The suction of the triple propeller Titanic was so powerful that the hawsers of the SS New York snapped off, causing dock workers to flee, avoiding getting hit by the dangerous flying ends of the mooring ropes. The only hawser that didn't break was the one holding the bow. The stern of the New York swung out toward the port side of the Titanic. In the nick of time, so just in time, tugboats moved into position and nudged the New York just enough so the Titanic cleared the stern of the ship by only a few feet. After the close call, Edith's father muttered to her, "This is a bad omen." So he's thinking that it's like bad luck, okay? He also wasn't pleased that the Titanic had departed behind schedule, claiming a ship leaving late spells bad luck. Thinking about her family's history, Edith wondered if her father said that because of what had happened to his brother. Years earlier, Thomas's brother, so that would be the young girl's uncle, had captained a ship that sank at sea in a tragedy that took his life. Then there was the bizarre incident mentioned by 12-year-old Roberta Bertha Watt, a fellow second-class passenger. On the afternoon of the Titanic's departure, Bertha had accompanied her mother to tea with several ladies. A woman at the table practiced the ancient art of reading tea leaves, a belief that the pattern made by the tea leaves at the bottom of a finished cup can tell the future of the tea drinker. After studying the empty cup of one of the ladies for several minutes, the tea leaf reader shook her head and admitted, "This is strange. I can't see anything. It's like there's just a blank wall and nothing beyond." "Is the Titanic doomed?" Edith wondered. She immediately pushed such an unpleasant thought from her mind. After all, this was the most thrilling time of her young life. She and her parents had left their home in Cape Town, South Africa, with plans to create a new life in Seattle, Washington. Her 60-year-old father, Thomas, was a well-respected investor and owner of several hotels in South Africa. Sporting a bushy mustache and always looking dapper, he was 20 years older than Elizabeth, a sweet-natured woman devoted to family and friends. Edith's parents doted on her, especially after her younger sister, Dorothy, died in 1908 at the age of 8 from diphtheria. Edith, who looked much younger than her age because she was short and slender, was given the best education possible. She and her parents often traveled to London to shop for clothes for themselves and fixtures for Thomas's hotel. Encouraged by Elizabeth's sister, Josephine, who lived in Seattle, the Browns decided to move there so Thomas could operate a new hotel. In February 1912, Edith and her parents sailed to England and spent several weeks in London, where Thomas booked second-class passage on the Titanic. For his American venture, Thomas bought linens, tableware, china, furnishings, and hotel equipment, which were put in the ship's cargo hold. Meanwhile, Edith and her mother went sightseeing and shopping. They bought the latest fashions, including full-length wool coats with velvet cuffs and lapels, and wide-brimmed hats and buttoned-up leather boots. The rest of the worldly possessions were kept in Thomas's leather Gladstone bag, a cross between a small suitcase and a large briefcase. The bag held cash, jewelry, gold coins, and important documents. Thomas also wore a money belt, which hid cash in a concealed compartment, and had gold coins sewn in his formal vests and in the hems of the women's coats. In those days, it was considered the safest way to travel with money. I'm going to stop there at the first paragraph of page 17. At this time, what I would like for you to do is to finish this chapter. We have all the background knowledge of what has happened before them getting onto the Titanic and the first couple days of them on the Titanic, going to the library, hearing about them having tea in the tea room with other ladies. Now I want you to finish this chapter on your own, and we will talk about it at the end of the week in a second video. I will also record another recording of the ending, along with a few questions that I have midweek, okay? Good luck reading. If you need anything, please message me on Teams, Remind, or email. Have a great day, boys and girls.